CIET-NCERT presents curriculum based series Dhwani Shala. So let's join in Dhwani Shala class 5.
Hello my dear children. Namaskar. I am your friend Akanksha Dwivedi and I hope you all are healthy and happy at your home. Now that you spend most of your time indoors, as you can't go to school, so I have come to help you with your lessons and also to share with you a few fun facts. I will be talking to you in English. Don't worry about English. If you listen carefully, you will understand all that I'm saying. Before we start, I want to ask you one thing. What are some of the things your parents and teachers tell you to do on time? As far as I remember, when I was of your age, my parents always asked me to get up in the morning and to do my homework on time or to pack my school bag, and I'm very sure you must be hearing similar things yourself. But the real question is, what happens when you don't do as they ask you to do? Kindly share your views on it with us, or you can even share an incident related to it. I'll wait for your insights. You may wonder why I'm telling you all this. Well, my dear children, this is because today we will listen to a story about flying together. So, are you interested? It is about a flock of geese and a hunter. And oh, let us not forget. What? I'll tell you. Do you want to know the full story? Yes, I know you must be saying yes. So, why don't you rush and get your Marigold Book 5 English textbook? If you have the book, open page number 29. I'll wait for you. If you don't have the book, it doesn't matter. You can still listen to the story. You can read it when you get the book later. Don't worry at all. Now, just listen carefully. Deep in a forest stood a very tall tree. Its leafy branches spread out like strong arms. This tree was the home of a flock of wild geese. Now, you may wonder what a flock is. Well, the flock is a collective noun used here to denote a group of geese. I am sure all of you have heard about geese. It's a kind of bird. I would like to mention some other collective nouns here. For example, a bunch of geese, a bunch of crapes, a troop of dancers, a pack of wolves, school of fish, a litter of cats, a litter of dogs, etc. A collective noun is a word or phrase that refers to a group of people or things as one entity. Collective nouns represent more than one person or thing in a class. It isn't possible to have just one lion in a pride, right children? Or it is not possible to have a single flower in a bucket. Thus, a collective noun always describes a plurality of one kind or another. Now, coming back to the story. They felt safe there. One of the geese was a wise old bird. He noticed a small creeper at the foot of the tree. He spoke to the other birds about it. "Do you see that creeper?" he said to them. "Let us destroy it." "Why must we destroy it?" asked a geese in surprise. "It's so small. What harm can it do?" "My friends," replied the wise old bird, "that little creeper will grow soon. As it creeps up this tree, it will become thick and strong." "What of that?" asked the geese. "What harm can a creeper do us?" "Let me tell you, children, do you know what a creeper is?" "Let me tell you, a plant that grows around the ground, around another plant, or up a wall by means of extending stems or branches, it is called a creeper." "Let me tell you about vines. A vine is a plant with a growth habit of trailing, that is, climbing stems or runners. The word vine can also refer to such stems or runners themselves. For instance, when used in wickerwork. So, now let us see what happens in the story. Hearing the geese's reply, the wise old bird looked and said, "Don't you see? With the help of that creeper, it will be possible for someone to climb on this tree. A hunter can come up and kill us all." "Well, there is no hurry," they replied. "The creeper is very small. It would be a pity to destroy it now." The wise old bird advised, "Destroy the creeper while it is young. Now it is tender and you can cut it easily. Later, it will become hard and you will not be able to cut it." But all the birds answered, "We'll see, we'll see." But they did not destroy the creeper. They forgot the wise old bird's advice. As the creeper grew, it began winding its way up to the tree. My dear children, to wind its way up to the tree here means to wrap, coil, or twist around the tree. And it was happening naturally. Let's move forward. Stronger and stronger it became until it was as strong as a thick rope. One morning, when the geese had gone out in search of food, a hunter came to the forest. "So this is where the wild geese live," he said to himself. "When they come back in the evening, I shall catch them." Now, the hunter is planning a plot to catch the wild geese. Let's see what happens next. The hunter climbed up the tree with the help of a creeper. He got to the top and spread his net there. He climbed down and went away. In the evening, The geese returned home. They did not notice the net. As they flew into the tree, they were trapped. They struggled hard to get out, but they could not. "Help! Help!" cried the geese. "We are caught in the hunter's net. Oh, what shall we do?" The wise old bird said, "Don't make a fuss now. Long ago, I told you to destroy the creeper, but you did not. Now see what has happened. Tomorrow morning, the hunter will come back and kill us all." Do you know, children, what is a fuss? Fuss means to show unnecessary or excessive concern. So, now all the birds were concerned. They were scared of the hunter. The bird said, "We were foolish. We were so sorry, and now we are very sorry. We did not listen to you. Please tell us what to do." The wise bird replied, "Then listen carefully. When the hunter comes, you must all pretend to be dead. Just lie still. The hunter will not harm dead birds. He will throw us to the ground. It will then be easy for him to climb down, collect the dead birds and take them home. When the last of us has been thrown down, we must quickly get up and fly away." In the morning, the hunter came to the tree and climbed up. He looked at the geese in the net. "They are all dead," he muttered to himself. He threw them out of the net one by one. The birds lay still until the last one had been thrown down. Then, all at once, they got up, flapped their wings, and flew away. The hunter was taken by surprise. From the top of the tree, he watched all the geese fly away. Remember how at the start of the story, we were worried about the poor birds and what would have happened with them. So children, did you like the story? What do we learn from this story? The lesson is a story on how a group of birds stay united and escape a trap by acting together in a timely fashion. Let us do an activity. I am reading out the sentences, and these are some common proverbs with two options with correct pronunciation, and I will ask you to tell me the correct option. So here we go. Number one is, necessity is the mother of invention or intention. Tell me children, think about it. Necessity is the mother of invention or intention. Let me help you with this. It is, necessity is the mother of invention. Yes, correct. Moving on to the next one. Honesty is the best policy or quality. What do you think, children? Honesty is the best policy. Yes, correct. Good things come to those who want or wait. Think about it, children. I'm giving you time. Good things come to those who wait. Next is, united we stand, divided we run or fall. What is it? Tell me. United we stand, divided we fall. Yes, so the correct answer would be, united we stand, divided we fall. Now you must be knowing the answer of this proverb. A friend in need is a friend in deed. Tell me, children, think about it. A friend in need is a friend in deed. Now the last one, bad excuses better than none or run. Tell me, children, bad excuses better than none or run. It is none. Bad excuses better than none. Interesting, right? These are some commonly used proverbs. I am sure you learnt a few new words by this story and activity too. Let us move on to the next activity. I will read the given passage with proper intonation twice. How many times? Twice. And then I will read out the statements one by one. Dear children, you will help me by saying true or false for each statement. Let us listen to the passage first. Here it goes. Gulliver was a doctor who lived in London. His greatest wish was to become a sailor. So, he loved to dream about traveling far into the seas. One day, Gulliver decided to join a ship's crew as a doctor. He said goodbye to his family and set sail for his first voyage. Now, children, I am repeating it once again. Gulliver was a doctor who lived in London. His greatest wish was to become a sailor. So, he loved to dream about traveling far into the seas. One day, Gulliver decided to join a ship's crew as a doctor. He said goodbye to his family and set sail on his first voyage. I will start with the sentences now. Of course, children, I will help you with this. Number one is, Gulliver was a professor. Is it true? Was he a professor? No, actually, he was a doctor. So, is this statement true? No. So, the statement is false. Second one. He lived in London. Did he live in London? Tell me, children. Yes, this statement is true. He lived in London. Number three, he has always dreamt to become the captain of a ship. I think this statement is false. Tell me, children, do you also think the same? Why? I'll tell you why. So this statement is false because his greatest wish was to become a sailor, not a captain. Right. Now, fourth one. He joined the airlines as a doctor. This statement is also wrong. I'll tell you why. Because he joined the ship as a doctor, not the airlines. Yes, I know you remember. He joined the ship as doctor, not the airlines. This is interesting, right? I hope you are enjoying this activity too. Moving on to the fifth one. He took his family along with him. Now, tell me children, did he take his family with him or did he just say goodbye to them? So this statement is also false. Sixth one, it was his first wish. Yes, this is so true. In the last line of the passage, we are told that it was his first wish. So, this statement is true. Let us discuss one more activity. I have a set of jumbled words. Rearrange them in a form of a sentence. Number one is, can parrot the fly? Think about it. I am giving you time. Children, so the proper order would be, the parrot can fly. Yes, this is the correct order. The parrot can fly. Second one, cat black is the. Think about it, children. Think hard. Cat black is the. So, after rearranging, the answer would be, the cat is black. Correct. The cat is black. Third one is, like I candy. Like I candy. So by now, it would be easier for you to give me the answer. Think about it. So the answer is, I like candy. I like candy. Interesting, right? I know, my dear children, you must be enjoying it. Fourth one is, web the spider a makes. Think about it. There are total 5 words. You have to arrange them in such a way that they frame meaning. So, tell me, web the spider a makes. The spider makes a web. Yes, this is the correct answer. Now, moving on to the last one. My friend is he. My friend is he. There are 4 words in total. Now, arrange these 4 words in such a way that they have a meaning. Try it yourself. I'm giving you time. Let me tell you, it would be, he is my friend. So easy, right? He is my friend. So, thank you, children. Lastly, I would like to conclude that the story of flying together teaches us great lessons about listening to our elders as they give wise advice and how working together can help overcome any hurdle. I hope you liked today's session. Kindly give your valuable feedback. Keep learning new things together in life with your family and friends. Now, very quickly, let us discuss the learning outcomes for this session. Dear children, by the end of this session, you are able to comprehend the concept of teamwork by the story, appreciate the importance of teamwork and motivate to comprehend jumbled words, listen to the passage with correct comprehension and answer the questions. All right, children, thank you. We'll see you in another session. Bye for now. Take care. Stay safe. Namaskar.
You are just listening to curriculum-based programs, Dhwani Shala. Production assistants, Tanu Gupta and Jagbandhu Jana. This program was recorded by Bati Langlingdo and technically assisted by Soumya Malik. Produced by Ajit Horo. This program was brought to you by CIET NCERT, New Delhi, India.